about this. No. Where I'm from, I've been raised in a house that we don't talk about mental health. We don't talk about how I'm feeling. No, I'm fine. Let's not talk about this. My parents won't allow me to talk to you. If we ignore it, this all goes away, right? I'm fine. I'm gonna be okay. Oh my God. Are all of you guys here to talk about this? This stuff that we've all been talking about all night long? This mental health? This well-being for our own sanity? LGBTQ, autism, that I'm not so unique, and there's other people like me? No way. No. All of you guys, it's Friday. Don't you guys have someplace to be? But yet you're here, and you actually might listen to me for a little while. So, hello everyone. My name is Trisha, Mrs. Graves. It's hard for me to do the whole last name thing. And I am your privileged school social worker. I am privileged to get to work with students on an individual basis in a way that no one else in the world gets to work with them. I get to hear stories that no one else in the world gets to hear from the unique individuals who come into my office. And for me, that's a privilege. That's a huge privilege. I hear stuff that you certainly don't tell your parents. I hear stuff that you're not sure about telling people that you say are your best friends. And I hear about stuff that you're surely not posting on social media. To me, this is a privilege, and I do not take it for granted at all. So bear with me as I read my notes, because I just wrote them, and I have no idea what I'm really up here to say. Because what do? I actually talk for a living. That's what I do. And what I say, it's not rocket science. It's just a different way of thinking about things. It's just sometimes my mind is so open and I accept things for exactly as it is, people think my brains are falling out. I'm just that open-minded. And so half the time I come to these things and I don't know, I figure it out as I go. So even though I'm this privileged social worker that gets to work on your campus, what does that mean to 2,900 kids? It certainly doesn't mean that I'm taking any of you out of your homes. Because isn't that what social worker is usually related to? Is someone who works for Department of Family and Children Services, for Child Protective Services, who removes kids from their home? That's not what I do. I am the equivalent of any therapist or counselor that exist in the professional world. The school is really lucky that you guys, 2,900 kids, get their very own therapist, kinda, on their very own schedule. And so, but no one knows about me. And those that know about me are so few, and they only know me behind a closed door. And so I'm trying to get out on campus and I'm trying to be known a little bit more, but there's still stigma. There's still a taboo for us to talk about this. There's still the concern that, but I can't get my parents' permission to talk about this because, well, that's what we don't talk about at home, right? So I have passed the exam for licensed clinical social worker. I formally and legally can diagnose anybody with a formal mental illness diagnosis, but that's not how I want to work with anybody. I don't want to give you a title. I want to work with whatever you're showing up with. What are your challenges and how can I support you? What are your, well, in my career, in my professionalism, in my job title, we call it, what are your symptoms? But you, really, it's just, what are you going through? So I talk to people all day. I get them to see things differently. And sometimes they look at me with this puzzled face like, you are so full of it. And my dad always said to me, when you want a real job that's gonna pay you real money, go ahead and let me know and I'll get you one. Crazy now, my parents live under my roof and I pay the rent for them. So now my dad accepts what I do for a living, isn't trying to give me another job, and he often says, really? Is that really how it is? I don't know, sounds good. You just gotta think differently sometimes. You gotta be open-minded to other experiences. So, everybody else has come up here and talked about themselves, and I don't wanna, in social work field, we don't divulge very much about our personal life, to be really honest, but there are a few things that I'm totally willing to talk about. I'm totally willing to talk about, I was a teenager once too. And you know what? I was a horrible person as a teenager. I apologize to my parents on a regular basis these days about everything I put them through when I was a teenager, because I was just mean. I was downright mean. And so, no one can ever take away the idea that we were all teenagers, and as much as times change, and as much as we've progressed about talking about some of this stuff, there's some things that never change about just what experiences you had during your high school years. Another thing about myself that I'm always more than willing to share is that I now have a freshman in high school. And my daughter goes to Silver Creek. And some of the stuff that I do here at work reminds me of how to be a good parent, reminds me of the stuff that my teenager is going through. And then I also have a son who is in transitional kindergarten, so he just turned 5. 9 years difference in my kid's age. Everyone says having a boy and a girl is so different. And of course the age is different, my life is different, so much is different about raising my children. But a fact about me and my children is that we all have ADHD. The older I get, the more I notice my symptoms and the more I struggle. The more I will look at my daughter, I realize that some of the stuff that I went through and some of the stuff I see her go through is because of the symptoms of our diagnosis. My son, he's too young. I won't give him a formal diagnosis yet. I know that it's coming. I know the 504 is coming as well. But let's just let the little guy be a little guy for right now. So it's my personal experiences that have led me to where I am. I've been born and raised on the east side of San Jose, been subjected to drugs and alcohol, heavy use, been the single parent, been the single parent going to school with a toddler. So it's these personal experiences that bring me to where I am, that have me think open-mindedly the way that I do, and want me to help high school students. Because sometimes I just wish I had that person when I was in high school. If I had that person to talk to that was so open-minded, that maybe life wouldn't have ended up the way that it did. Maybe it would have been easier on me. So I like to be that person for everyone here at this campus and beyond. As much as my ability, I know my limits. But the other thing is that my job experiences that I've had make me, quote, an expert on some of these topics that we're talking about up here. So I've worked in a locked state psychiatric hospital inside of a prison. I used to be the director of a drug and alcohol treatment facility, a 30-day all-women's residential. And since these are my jobs since my master's, because prior to my master's I worked with kids. And then my most recent job that I was at the longest was working at the county locked psych unit with severely mentally ill. That's when I realized I don't want to do this anymore. I actually wanted to go back with kids because every day I reintroduced myself to my clients because they couldn't remember who I was or what I was there to do for them. That wasn't exactly where I wanted my career to go. I wanted to do more and help people and make an impact. So that's what qualifies me to do my job. Yeah, I have a master's. Obviously, I have a bachelor's. I now have a clinical license. And according to a lot of job descriptions, that's what makes me eligible to do my job. But it's much, much beyond all of that. So I'm a resource here on campus. I'm here for all of the students. What I see the most is students dealing with anxiety. I see students coming to me to talk about how they're a first generation teenager in the US and the challenges that come with their home life versus school life versus them finding themselves. Of course, I can't ignore the drugs and alcohol, especially vaping and marijuana right now on campus. So I'm a resource. I talk to students, I help them out, I give them some insight, give them some assistance, and then I'm also a resource to your resources. I can stand up here and rattle off a bunch of 800 numbers for you. Oh yeah, that's another big job that I had that was like hugely impactful, was that I had the position of writing. I worked nights, and I went to wherever a youth was who was either suicidal or homicidal, and I wrote 5150s, and I placed them in locked psychiatric hospitals. I did that for 4 years. So when I'm called to a crisis, been there, done that. This stuff never freaks me out, never has freaked me out. Nothing like shocks me. I'm not easily shocked by anything. I've heard it all and I accept it all. And what bothers me the most is when people lie to me, because I'm like the last person to lie to. Because it's not necessary, I guess, is why it bothers me so much. So I know the phone numbers for Uplift to call when someone's suicidal and you want them to get assessed. I know the phone numbers to call for crisis hotlines throughout the nation, for mental health hotlines, how to get therapists out in the community. So I'm the resource to the resources. So I can get you guys more, or I can get you guys just me and able to talk to just me. So I have no idea. I meant to set a timer. I have no idea if I'm ahead or behind or whatever, but I just decided on Wednesday I was speaking today, and I always want to do speaking engagements, and then I'm like, oh, but what do I talk about? Because my job is very, very broad. I cover everything. Any student comes with me with anything, I'm supposed to have some kind of response to them. And so, so I just try to help you guys understand that you guys have a resource that is willing and very privileged to be here on campus with you guys, that you guys have at your fingertips at any time. So how do you contact me to get to either to me or get to those other resources that I can give to you? I'm on School Loop. You can go under Student Life and then under Student Support Services. There's actually a link to do a direct referral to me. You can email me through School Loop. You can come to my office, which is across from the Parent Center, which most people still don't know where I sit. D108, if anyone is knowledgeable about the D building. Yeah, those are the three ways that you guys can get to me. A direct referral, or of course, please do not underestimate that teachers refer you to me, that advisors refer you to me, administrators refer you to me, and other peers refer you to me. Because what happens is that they've met with me, they see that it's a safe situation, and then they're like, hey, by the way, can you meet with this kid? Because this kid's having this problem. So you can refer yourself, or sometimes you guys get referred to me by other sources. Either way, I'm here for you guys as much as you guys would like to utilize me. I'm super excited to see that so many people have come tonight. And hopefully, we'll just keep having this conversation. Have a good night.